Well, good morning. It is so good to see you. Wow, did you guys enjoy that rain last night and the lightning? Oh, it was beautiful. We were coming back from Simi Valley, so the whole sky was just, the lightning would hit and it was like this purple. It was so beautiful. I'm so glad you are here with us. And if you're out there in Facebook land, welcome, Barbie. We miss you. Have a great time. Probably, where is she today? She's with Ruth?
Nebraska, yeah.
Nebraska, okay.
Hebron, yeah.
Okay. Well, let's stand up. Let's worship the Lord because He is good. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. To your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for compassion so amazing. Lord, we come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed because of your love. Yeah, as we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for compassion so amazing. Lord, we come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed because of your love.
Because of His love.
Because of your love.
We're forgiven.
We're forgiven.
Because of His love.
Because of your love.
Our hearts are
clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed because of your love.
Amen. It is so good to be in this house this morning.
When all that's within me feels dry, this is my prayer and my hunger and need. My God is the God who provides. This is my prayer in the fire, in weakness or trial or pain. There is a faith through them more worth than gold, so refine me, Lord, through the I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against majesty shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on his promise I'll stand. I will bring praise, I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. Season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship.
Time, all of my life.
All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. This is my prayer in the harvest, when favor and providence. Filled to be empty again, the seed I received I will sow.
Amen. Good morning. I wanted to take a moment. As we sang those songs, I was thinking about all of my life in every season. Doesn't matter where you are still God. And I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. It doesn't matter what I'm going through, where, if I'm in the mud or on top of a hill singing, God is still there and just, he is worthy of everything. I wanted to take a moment. I had a miracle this week and I wanted to share it because he is so good, you know? Last Sunday we talked about, you know, that God loves us so much. I mean, he even takes care of the birds. And how much more does he love us? You know, I had to take my dog into the vet. When he got hurt, when we came back from the lake, his spleen was enlarged. And they said, he's probably going to need surgery. So I took him back in because I wanted to reevaluate him. And we were sitting there and we were talking. The vet and I were talking, and he's a good friend of mine. And he was talking, and he's talking about a tumor. And I'm like, wait a minute, a tumor? He's like, yeah, that's what this is. And I'm like, oh, okay. I didn't even. So they took Chance back to do an x-ray. And I was like, okay, God, I'm not ready to give up this dog yet. So he came back in and he says, do you believe in miracles? And I said, absolutely. He says, it's gone. The tumor is gone. His spleen is great. No need for surgery. So he says he was so excited, and I was wearing my faith shirt, and he knows I'm a believer, because it's a joke between us, because his brother was severely injured, almost died, and Craig and I constantly prayed for him for months, and he got better, and I mean, it was a miracle. I mean, it was just amazing. So I said, I prayed your brother back from death. You saved my dog. You know, it's one of those things. And he took me back, and we looked at the x-ray, and he's like, this is what it was when he came in when he got hurt, and this is it now. And he goes, look, it's gone. And he was like, it's him, it's him. And it was such a great witness. So then he's like, but this is just the picture, and the tumor could be underneath, so let's do an ultrasound. So we got the dog up on the table, and I was able to stay with him. And it was the vet, and there were two guys there holding him and getting everything set. And the veterinarian said to the two guys, this is a woman of faith. And I said, absolutely. So they checked for his spleen, and the one guy started laughing. He goes, look, it's completely fine. And then I said, when I was in, there was also, he was having gallbladder issues. So they looked at the gallbladder. And he's like, it's completely fine. This dog is fine, 100%, doesn't need surgery. And I was like, you know what, God, even just healing this dog is just a blessing. It doesn't matter what you're going through. He is so good. Amen? Amen. And I just wanted to thank him for what he does, you know? Amen. So, as we continue to worship, I want you to take a moment and just find your quiet spot. And just focus on God and just thank him for what he's done. In Ephesians 1:18, it says, this is Paul, it's part of Paul's prayer to Ephesus. But it says, I pray that God will open your minds to see his truth. Then you will know the hope that he has chosen us to have. You will know that the blessings God has promised his holy people are rich and glorious. So, Lord, I ask you, come into this place this morning. Open our hearts and open our minds to what you have for us, that we can see you and only you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of eyes of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Holy, holy, holy.
His faithful follower I would. done. When by grace the victory's won, even death's cold wave, I will not flee. Since God through Jordan leadeth me, He leadeth me.
Deserves a yee-haw at the end. Yeah. Amen, amen.
Holy words long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us go in this world wherever we roam. Ancient will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words long preserved for our walk this word, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts.
Father, we come this morning and we we open up our hearts and let those ancient words, the holy word, invade us. I pray over this service this morning, Father, that you come and give us your word. Change us from the inside out this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, praise team. That was wonderful. I love the words, and everything that we sang just speaks so beautifully. So, opening the Word of God. Let's pause and pray again. Father, you are creator of everything. Lord, the stars and the planets, this cosmos, the universe, and things that we don't even know or understand. And you created this little tiny planet that is so big to us, Barbie driven halfway across it, it feels like. But Lord, you spoke, and everything came into being, including us. Before the creation of the world, you knew us and you formed us in our mother's wombs through the miracle of matter coming together. Yet you breathed your breath of life into our lungs. And you made us for your purposes. And you made us to worship you, to come into relationship with you, to be your children. And Lord, as we just sang, opening these ancient words that are thousands and thousands and thousands of years old, yet so very relevant to us today. Lord, we reach up as little children and take your hand as you lead us, as we walk through your words. Lord, we're failed and flawed, and we feel weak. But you are strong. So in our weakness, in our inability to comprehend at times what you're really trying to say to us, as we just sang, open the eyes of my heart. Let us understand your truths anew today. Even things that we may have read 100 or 1,000 times before. Lord, as we open your word and you open your will and we open our hearts and we open our minds, lead us, direct us. May the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart, everything that we think and say and do, be pleasing in your sight, because you are our rock and our redeemer. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay. Well, good morning, brothers and sisters. It's wonderful to see you, and greetings to those who are elsewhere in the country and or world. Let me get everything started here. Okay, I want to, this is actually part 4 of the Clash of Cultures series. I could have called this the Sermon on the Mount gathering. So today's subtitle is Kingdom Values. And again, I want to point out that the photo on the left is our worldview. And I can stand here and safely tell you that for most of my life, I read most of the Bible incorrectly, let me put it that way. I mean, I understood it. I studied it. You know, I have three degrees in it, which is not bragging at all. It's just telling you how dense I am. You know, I really had to work hard to try to study this stuff. And as I'm really swimming in the Sermon on the Mount, sometimes I feel I'm over my head. A seminary professor said of the book of John, He said, John is the most beautiful gospel because it's shallow enough for a child to play on the beach and understand, yet deep enough for an elephant to swim in. And I feel the same for the Sermon on the Mount because it's so powerfully simple, yet so deep that even as I continue to really, really delve into this, I feel woefully inadequate to present this material to you. How do you take Jesus' words and expound on them? I even thought, gosh, every one of the four sections that we're going to cover today could be an individual sermon, a whole message. And so I am choosing not to see from my perspective, but to see from the kingdom perspective what Jesus wants to teach us. So we're in the book of Matthew, chapter 7. But let's look at an overview. Let's just set our minds on where we're at. In our pilgrimage to become healthy disciples in a healthy church. And it's a goal. It's a destination. It's an undiscovered country. It's something that we are, we have, we exist in, but we're still searching for. So it's the both and. Right? We're continuing in this journey to be healthy disciples in a healthy church because that's what Jesus wants for us. We are learning Jesus' highest values, that Jesus' highest values are kingdom living and love. So let that sink in for a minute, because if you could summarize definitely what we're covering today, maybe for the entire Sermon on the Mount. Jesus' highest values are living in the kingdom, living effectively in the kingdom with open eyes and open hearts, being real in the kingdom, okay? And this is the kingdom of God. It's the kingdom of the heavens. It's the reality with which Jesus is open-handedly saying, you can walk and live and breathe and eat and act in the kingdom. So that's kingdom living and love. Okay, we've struggled and talked, and we'll even go further in understanding agape love. And it's such an inexhaustible topic because agape love is the love of God, God's love, right? And so we have to contrast it with our love, with different kinds of love, but just the depth of understanding God's love, living in the kingdom values and in agape love. So if we do not have these things as actual values, as opposed to wished for values, we will spiral into legalism. And I want to stop there because probably the majority of the sermon today is going to be introductory matter. I'll warn you that. I think I have four slides of it, and then we'll get into the meat of the subject. But because we're in chapter 7, and the Sermon on the Mount is 5, 6, and 7 in Matthew, right? And so this is the late mid part of Jesus' movement on the message. Wished for values versus actual values. And the reason I want to stop here is because we, in our left picture worldview, we have things that we hope for that we actually don't practice, okay? And so that's the difference between an actual value and a wished for value or a hoped for value. An example is, say, I want to be a witness. You know, I want to tell people about Jesus. And so I say, you know, my value is telling people about Jesus. But you ask me, well, when's the last time you told somebody about Jesus? And I go, Well, it was 2 or 3 years ago. It was that guy. Is your actual value that value? okay? Because we live and operate and act in our values, not our hoped-for values, okay? And that's just a theological. We have values, you know. One of my values is drinking coffee every day, right? So it can be a whole bunch of different things. But if we don't have these actual values that Jesus is talking about, we will spiral into legalism. And that's the thing that I want to caution us. I've even struggled with the headings. Like I did a couple weeks ago, I put the little, you know, anti-mark on some of the headings. And even today, it's kind of both and. So I'm not going to go to town or be at issue with the people who put the titles in front of the chapters or the markers, you know, the sections. But sometimes Jesus isn't actually talking about that. He's actually talking about something deeper. And I think that's the beauty of the Sermon on the Mount, is he's getting to the heart of the matter early on, right? This is the beginning of his ministry. And so one thing I'd love to do, I might do in the coming weeks, is compare and contrast some of Paul's teachings with the Sermon on the Mount, and maybe even Jesus' teachings, because whereas he set a plan in order, and we're going to talk about how it is very intentional the way that Jesus spoke, this is like the Cliff's Notes. Okay, I mean, he gave us all the stuff right up front, and then for 3 years he worked it out with them. And you and I are much like the disciples that walked with him. We didn't get it a lot of the times. And so we have to continue to come back and relearn and learn, because that's what a disciple of Jesus is an apprentice, a learner, learning from Jesus, you know, how to live my life as if he were living it. So I don't want us to spiral into legalism or the rightness of the scribes and Pharisees, which is what Jesus is continually holding up. Jesus is calling you and me to kingdom values. As we continue to wade in the shallows of the Sermon on the Mount, sometimes dropping off a cliff and struggling for air, we frequently find that we are in over our heads. Jesus' teaching is so simple yet so profound. In our childlike fumbling around in this mountain message, we come to realize we are not alone. Our Father is holding our hand as the waves arrive. With delight, we begin to understand the profound beauty and majesty of His word to us. We are learning to see through kingdom eyes. Father God is patient and gives us the space and time to learn. We learn how we judge others in the standard by which we are judged. We learn how to be persistent in prayer and sharing Christ, and how to treat others. Finally, we learn that a good tree can't produce bad fruit. And that's going to be next week, by the way. If our perspective is centered on the kingdom, we will produce good fruit. So, I want to put this up one more time. These are the key questions that Jesus is asking yet answering in the Sermon on the Mount. Who is well off? What does it mean to be blessed? Who is a blessed person? How to live the good life? Who is a really good person, and how to become a really good person? So, now this is a big one. I resisted putting this up until now, but this is basically, in full confession, most of my material comes from John Eldridge and Dallas Willard. I listen. As a matter of fact, Chapter 7 of the Spirit, the Divine Conspiracy, is about Chapter 7 of the Gospel of Matthew, and I have listened to Dallas Willard's teaching. It's the book. On Chapter 7, 20 or 30 times, just listening over and over, trying to get the depth at which the level of understanding. So much of this is from Dallas, but this is basically an outline of the surrender of the will to the care of the Father, the heart that Jesus gives us, okay? A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, right? So trusting in Jesus will bring us to being the kind of person who. Now let me stop before we read these. Remember, we're As we're working on becoming a healthy disciple in a healthy church, we're trying to identify what are the actions, what are the behaviors, what's the speech and the thought and the heart of an effective follower of Jesus Christ. So we're talking about spiritual disciplines. We're talking from the big, broad to the macro, right? And we're making lists of basically what do I need to do, what do I need to be in order to be an effective follower of Christ. Well, this is a really good one, and this is straight out of the Sermon on the Mount. So I put in bold the kind of person who. So you kind of have to add that to the beginning of every sentence, because Jesus is teaching us the kind of person who lives a life free of contempt and anger. Okay, and look where Jesus begins. Okay, after the Beatitudes, Jesus hits the thing that affects us in life most is anger and contempt. Okay, and then he's bringing us to the place to where we can be the kind of person who is free from dominion by sexual lust and disgust. Okay, he hits the big ones right off. Okay, third, we're trying to become the kind of person who is free of desire to dominate and control verbally. Okay, we're working, we're participating in becoming the kind of person who is free from grudges, fairness, and payback. Okay, that's Matthew 5:38-42. We're continuing to work with the Lord as he brings us to become the kind of people who, the kind of person, I debated whether to do people or person, but I decided I was going to do it individually, so it should be the person every time. So the person who is able to love enemies and bless those who curse, etc. We are working to become the kind of person who does not perform for human credit. Okay, I can confess right there that I spent most of my life performing for human credit. That's what a codependent does. Okay, so I am now working on not performing for human credit. I'm trying to become the kind of person who does not trust in physical substance, money, possessions, wealth, anything material. Okay, we're working together to become the kind of person who does not menace others by condemnation, or what we're going to call today condemnation engineering. And that's Matthew 7, 1 through 12, which we're about to jump into. And then just for this week, we're working on becoming the kind of person who is one who walks the narrow way. Okay? So now this is up there. It's on Facebook. You can always go back and look at it. If you want, I can send you a PDF of this, or I can send you the whole PowerPoint. Now, the centrality of the order is something that Dallas talks about. And this is a quote. These are quotes from him. Working through the Sermon on the Mount, we've struggled, we've waded, we've swam in these things that we are laying aside anger and contempt. We're laying aside cultivation of lusting and verbal manipulation, payback, and getting even, along with the burdens of anxiety and looking good and securing ourselves through wealth. If we're still dominated with anger, contempt, and lusting, still ruling our house with an iron lung, the tender areas into which Jesus moves in chapter 7 will be incomprehensible. We must start at the point where Jesus began, who is good. Okay, who is blessed, going back to the Beatitudes. And so he says, blessed are the poor, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Blessed are those who mourn, who are humble, who hunger and thirst for righteousness, the merciful, whose hearts are pure, who work for peace, because they will be called the children of God, and for those who are persecuted for doing right. So I want to stop because, as I've said to you, the majority of my life, I found the Sermon on the Mount hard, right? We've talked about that a little bit before, and I think this is the answer. It was incomprehensible because I was looking at it from flesh, from just, it's just another set of rules. And if it's just another set of rules, oh my gosh, it's impossible. I can't do that. So what we're doing is we're changing our cultural perspective to understand that I can't do this by myself. Okay, I can only receive agape love and let him work through me, and I'm cooperating with him so that I can be the kind of person through whom all these things are working and effective and transforming and changing my life. Now, it doesn't absolve me, okay? I want you to get that. It does not take away my responsibility. It's all up to God, and all I have to do is just exist. No, I have to cooperate. I have to participate. And so these are very important things that I have to work on. And what is common unto man, right? Ancient words, ever true, right? This stuff was written 2,000 years ago, okay? But remember, this earlier stuff was written like 6,000 years ago. Okay, a long, long, long time ago. So these are ancient words, but they're from the non-time-limited eternal God, right? So they're relevant yesterday, 2,000 years ago, 6,000 years ago. They're relevant today because they are God's word for us. And the things that people struggled with 2,000 years ago are the things that we struggle with today, okay? So hopefully there's some comfort in that. That you and I are not alone. Yes, we all have issues of anger and contempt. We all have issues of condemnation, which we're going to talk a little bit about today. We all have sexual issues. We all struggle with money. And that's okay. Because we are a confessional people who are saying, okay, yes, I struggle with that, but I'm opening the eyes of my heart and I'm saying, Lord, come into my heart and show me where you are at work in me and what I need to work on. So that's the participation. That's working with God. So the last thing I want to say on this slide is these are not unrelated points. Some people will look at the Sermon on the Mount, especially chapter 7, and they'll say, well, Jesus just kind of threw these in, or maybe the writer thought, oh, yeah, this would be good to put here, or this would be good to put here. Think about Jesus as the most intelligent human ever. Okay, because he's Almighty God. He knew everything. I don't know how he could be in this form with this little thing up here. I can only assume that we use about 10% of our brain, right? That's what science tells us. I guess he was probably using about 100% of his brain, right? Because he understood. Yet at the same time, so that he could be fully human, he limited himself. And I don't get that. I don't fully understand it because he was fully God and fully man, yet for a season, he limited himself to become like us, right? So he could fully understand what it was like to be human. And so Jesus knew what he was doing because he was the most wise person ever. For this, and as we said last week, for whatever you do, right? He's the most intelligent person. So if you have a challenge, a struggle, a problem, okay, go to Jesus, right? If it's about your dog, if it's about your job, about your car, or about your kids, it doesn't matter. Jesus knows the answer. Wait, Jesus is the answer, right, for the world today? Jesus is the answer, okay? And he knows everything. And so if he's the most intelligent person, he's also the most loving person and kind person who can be trusted, right? So you and I have trust issues, right? Because our experience, our culture, has come through human beings. And so our idea of father, our idea of mother, big brother, big sister, family, children, friends, community, culture, country, whatever it is, right? We get all that through unfiltered sin, right? Humanness. And so we have trust issues because that's where we learn it. But the process of discipleship is learning to not see God as Father the way my father fathered me, but the way God fathered Jesus. And Jesus can teach us how to love the Father and how to receive the Father's love. Right? I told you there's a whole bunch of mini sermons in this one sermon. So we need to keep moving on or I'm going to totally run out of time. So Dallas said this. Got a lot of quotes from Dallas today. We have already laid aside anger, contempt, cultivation of lusting, verbal manipulation, payback, and getting even, along with the burden of anxiety or looking good and securing ourselves through wealth. I already read that. I had that up there twice. Okay, good. I thought so. Okay, so we're going to jump into it. So let's look at chapter 7. This is verses 1 through 6. Jesus said, "Do not judge others, and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. And why worry about the speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, 'Hey, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye,' when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite." Except there's an exclamation point over it. So I should say, hypocrite. First, get rid of the log in your own eye. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Don't waste what is holy on people who are unholy. Don't throw your pearls to pigs. They will trample the pearls. Then they will attack you. I tell you, there could be an entire message just on those six verses. And you'll see that I've got a lot of information up here. So basically, it comes down to condemnation. Okay, the word here in the Bible is do not judge others, and you won't be judged. Now, does that mean that we won't be judged? No, we will be judged before the great throne of God, right? The moment we die, we will be standing before a holy God. And everything that we've ever done or said or been will be understood by us and everyone, everything else. So we will face judgment. But who's going to be standing there right with us? Right? Jesus. And he will say, "No, I paid the price. All of that is taken care of. They are in me and I am in them." And we will be invited into eternal glory, right? But we're not there yet. So Jesus said, "Don't judge and you won't be judged. For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged." Wow. So it comes down to the idea of condemnation. The deadly way in which we try to manage or control those closest to us. We work really hard to manage our world on our own, in our own flesh, the best we can. We're just making our way in the world today, right? Condemnation is so much a part of our worldview and our culture. Yes, sometimes we feel we are on the right side, therefore we have a right to condemn, okay? And Jesus is talking about that. But when we condemn someone, we possibly inadvertently, I don't think we actually ever really intend to do this, though sometimes we may, we're actually saying that person is bad, is somehow not good. And so we are judging them, right? And we're saying this person is not good. We don't always intend to do that, but it frequently happens. So Jesus is saying, wait a second, how can you say to another person you have a speck in your eye, right? Judging, hey, you got something wrong with you. When we have this huge plank in our eye, what is Jesus talking about? He's talking about the fact that we judge others is the plank in our eye. We are blinded by our own inadequacies, our own failures, our own faults, our own sin nature, so that we can't see what's wrong with us. It's kind of a natural thing. It's always easier to see somebody else's problem than your own, okay? And I think that's natural to our human state, is that, you know, blinders on a horse, right? Or myopic means one eye. You know, the Cyclops, he only has one eye, so he doesn't have 360 or more peripheral vision. And so we are naturally delusional or self-unaware because of this. The plank condemnation, our condemning others, is actually the thing that Jesus is talking about. So we should and can become the person, the kind of person who does not judge or condemn others. And remember, we go back to the very beginning where Jesus starts off talking about anger and contempt, because anger leads to contempt and contempt always leads to condemnation. And guess what condemnation leads to? Usually shame. And we deal with a lot of shame, but it also usually leads around to anger, okay? So it's a vicious cycle of when we condemn, there's either shame or anger or contempt, and those things are relationship killers. They're destroyers. I mean, it is Satan's way of using our natural human flesh, our natural human tendencies, A, to hurt us, but especially to hurt others, okay? And Jesus is saying here, do not judge and you will not be judged. So if we're still dominated with anger, contempt, and lusting, still ruling our hearts with an iron lung, as he said, the tender areas into which Jesus moves will be incomprehensible. So no condemnation. There is no need to be anxious. As we become Jesus' friends, he renews our spirit, and Jesus shows us how we can truly be the kind of people who are genuinely at home, comfortable in God's kingdom. Okay? And look at Romans 8:1. This verse, I don't know, guys. I've always known it. Well, not always. Okay, maybe I was a little kid. I probably memorized it, right? VBS and all that stuff. You memorize a lot of scripture when you're a kid. There is no condemnation for those in Christ. I got it theologically, right? I understood, okay, because I came to faith when I was 7. I confessed my sin. I walked forward in a church and, you know, and I met the pastor. And then the next Sunday I was baptized. So I had a little certificate, right? So I came to faith in Christ at 7, and I realized there is no condemnation from Christ. And I got that. I didn't get that there is no condemnation in Christ. And so, confessionally, I lived most of my life as a condemning person. Now, why did I do that? The last few years has been a beautiful, terrible hell of discovering why. Okay, I had my wounds that caused me to put up walls, and my walls were defenses, but I had to put up secondary things that were the things that I did to hurt other people. And so my condemnation was to cover up the fact that I really wasn't proud, that I was really hurt and wounded and ashamed because of my woundings. And so I was a judgmental person, condemning person. I can fully openly confess that I was a very high and mighty, superior, better than thou type of person who judged others. And I didn't realize what I was doing, how I was doing it, and the depth of the damage that it can do when we condemn one another. And so I confess that, and I repent, right? R-A-C, RAC, repent, confess, and admit. I admit that I was a failure when it came to operating in agape love, because I was seeing just new rules. So I had to work really hard, okay? So let's move on. Agape love. Agape love is illustrated in verses 1 through 10 in these three ways. Not condemning or blaming others, right? If we truly, and guys, in the introduction we said kingdom living and love, and I should have put agape love in there because we have so many different words for love, and we have so much, we have human love, but we're talking about agape love. And so can we become the kind of people who are not condemning or blaming others? Now I wish I were there. I can tell you I'm working on it. I still have my human natural tendencies, but I'm beginning in the same way when I'm cut off or when a car goes past me in traffic, I stop and I say, okay, what am I feeling right now? Why am I irritated? Why is my spirit upset with that person? In the same way, I'm stopping myself when I tend to judge or blame others for what is happening to me or what is happening in our world or our culture or whatever it is. And I'm asking Jesus to come into the broken places in my heart and say, Lord, what's up and what can you teach me? What are you trying to teach me in this? So agape love, B, is not forcing the wonderful things upon the other. Okay, now I want to stop here for a minute because in a moment you're going to see that Jesus is not necessarily talking about, the answer to this is not necessarily talking about prayer. It's talking about interacting with one another. And the second thing is not forcing the wonderful things upon them. This means that what I see in you that you need to do, right? Again, we can always see things much better in others than we can see in ourselves. It may be something that I need to work on. And I did realize, I was explaining to my friend this week, what I realized was happening when the car cuts me off or when the car goes fast, and I'm asking Jesus, okay, what's going on in me? Why am I irritated with them? I realize that that becomes a mirror, and I'm actually looking at my weakness, okay, and my trying to cover up for my inadequacies, okay, which may be the reason why the guy drives the big truck. You know, he's trying to cover up for his inadequacies or his feelings of failure or weakness, right? And so I'm seeing that as a mirror, and I'm going, okay, I let it go, and I even sing the song because I'm all alone. But not forcing wonderful things upon them, part of that is the gospel. And Tony and I were actually talking about this earlier a little bit. The good news of Jesus Christ is a seed, okay? And yes, Matthew 28:18-20, all authority is given in heaven and on earth. To me, Jesus said, go and make disciples. As you are going about your life, make disciples. How we go about that is basically just offering people the seed, okay? And it could be through a witness. It could be through a gospel presentation. It could be through a smile or a hug or some kind of tenderness in a moment where they need love and they know who you are and, you know, you share. So I want to tell you that, yes, we are responsible to plant the seeds, but we're not, Jesus teaches us in the Word, that we don't make it grow. I mean, we plant the seed, and yes, we may need to pull some weeds, okay, because that's important, and we may need to water it, but we may move along, and God brings somebody else, and they water, okay? We're not responsible for the seed sprouting and growing and a person coming to faith in the kingdom of God necessarily, okay? So the reason why I bring this up here is when we are rejected, how does that make us feel? Okay, if you share the good news with somebody and you offer, would you like to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And they go, no. Are you okay with that? Okay, because that is what Jesus is speaking about when he's saying we offer in love, realizing that the person may reject the message, which that's between them and God, but we think they're rejecting us. Okay, so not forcing wonderful things upon someone else. And think about it. Does God force us to come to faith in him? Absolutely not. I mean, he is the sovereign, almighty king of the universe. Boom, he could have come at any time in all this creation, revealed himself for all the glory he was, and everybody would have fallen flat and said, yes, you are the king of the universe. Yes. But he didn't, right? He came as a baby in a manger and lived for 30 years and taught for 3 years. And that was 2,000 years ago. So God is at work slowly in this world, growing us, growing his kingdom, right? It's alive and active and spreading throughout this world in amazing ways that we don't even get to know about, okay? But not forcing the wonderful things upon another individual, that's part of condemnation, is you need to do this, okay? And we get it from our parents and we practice it with our children. And we maybe need to really ask the Lord, hey, am I actually loving the other person, my son, enough to let him deal with what he's got going between he and God? Now, yes, I want to speak the truth in love, and I want to be a witness. I want good for other people. But if God doesn't force people, who am I to think that I can? Okay, and this really hits me. I'm stepping on my own toes here because most of my life, I mean, I was a missionary for 32 years in Japan, right? On a daily basis, we were going out and we were meeting Japanese people and we were giving them the Bible. We were giving them portions, you know, what do they call those? Tracts. You know, we're giving tracts. We're giving all kinds of videos and everything. We were trying to get Japanese people to come to faith in Christ. And in Japan, that's a tough job because you get a lot of rejection. And when you're rejected a lot by the people and the culture, it gets really hard. And so it's easy to condemn and say, well, you know, they just don't want to come to faith in Christ. But not forcing that on them is actually love. Offering, here, you can have this. And so the third one is just asking for what we want from them and from God. Okay, so this is the important thing. We're not absolved from offering the good news to other people. Okay, that's a command. You and I are as disciples of Jesus Christ, and if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you're a disciple. We'll talk more about that at another time. But we are to offer, but we're just asking them, and we're going to talk in a minute about inviting, but at the same time, we're asking God, okay? We're saying, here's the message, here's the good news, but I'm in constant relationship with God and saying, God, I need your help. I need you, Holy Spirit, to work in their lives so that you bring them to the place to where you want them to be. Now, that may be on the witnessing level, which is what I'm talking a lot about, but it may also be on the son and daughter, the child level, or the friend, or the neighbor, the irritating neighbor, right? Not only am I asking them for what I want is good, okay, in love, but I'm also talking to the Father about it, okay? Because God, when I work with God, he does amazing things. And I continually talk about, all I do is offer, I bring my little 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's all I got. All I have in life is just little 5 loaves and 2 fish. I don't have much. But when he takes it, man, he feeds thousands. It's amazing, okay? So we have to move on to the second one. Now, the title in the Bible over this paragraph, two paragraphs, is effective prayer. And so I changed it this morning because let's read it and let's see what he's talking about. Is he talking about effective prayer or persistent, patient asking? Okay, listen to this. So chapter 7, verse 7, keep on asking and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking and you will find. Keep on knocking and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and to everyone who knocks the door will be open. You parents, if your children ask for a loaf of bread, do you give them a stone instead? Or if you ask for a fish, do you give them a snake? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? Okay? Yes, it is about prayer, and it's about effective or persistent prayer, but also it's about persistent asking. Okay, again, we're not, if we're rejected by a suggestion without condemnation, that's what Jesus is really saying. He's saying, can we become the kind of people who can offer to another person a different perspective, something that we may see that they may or may not need, if we don't have the plank in our own eye, right? The whole point is take care of condemnation, of judging, of anger, and all these things that we've done before. Take care of that. You know, work on yourself. Then, asking the Father, Lord, how do I talk to this person about this thing that they're struggling with? Okay? How can I be agape love, which is wanting the best for the other person, not what I think is best? Okay, there's the challenge. Oftentimes, I think I know what's best for the other person. And that sure does make me godlike. And boy, I don't want to be godlike, right? Because the lightning's going to strike. You know, this is a lightning rod. Do you guys ever do that when you were young? You know, got to have a lightning rod because God's going to strike. I don't ever want to be in the position to where I am God. Okay, I want to be in the position to where I am trusting in my Heavenly Father who can do anything, can work miracles. I mean, raise the dead, feet straightened out, eyes opened. I mean, He can do amazing things. He can heal the brokenness inside a person's heart. Okay, healing is still happening in our world today. It may not necessarily be physical, though I believe that can happen, but He's healing my heart and He's healing my mind. Oops. The other way around, right? My heart and my mind. And He's healing us, okay? He's at work. And so as I'm trusting in my Father, I'm asking Jesus to work in my life and make me the person to where I can approach somebody in love, agape love, and ask, okay? So persistent, patient asking. So it's the idea of the way of request. So I put some words up here, some thoughts. Inviting, okay? And the reason why this hits me so strong, guys, is I've told you a little bit about my healing journey, right? So in EMDR, which is this therapy thing where you sit with a counselor and you have these headphones, these little pads, and what that does is the sound goes back and forth, so beep, 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 right? And then the pads are also the same thing, so it's beep, 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 beep. You're feeling and you're hearing and you're closing your mind, your eyes, and opening your mind. And you're experiencing what your mind needs to tell you. And in this process, I was very much asking Jesus to be at work in my life. But as I discovered my wounded parts, I realized, as I've told you guys before, one of my supersuits, I guess, was condemnation. Call me Dr. Condemnation, right? I was good at condemning. And so I had judged and condemned and executed, you know, judge, jury, and prosecution, right? Judge, jury, and executioner. I had condemned my parts. And so the one thing that this process taught me was I needed to humble myself and repent and apologize. I know this is really sound weird, but it's what happened to me, so it's my story. I had to apologize to my parts, my wounds, my wounded parts of me, and invite them to trust Jesus. So if that can be an illustration for you and me, we deal on a daily basis with wounded, broken, hurting people. You can't spit without hitting somebody, okay? That's that way. No matter where you are, no matter what you do in your work, in your stores, everywhere we are, we deal with broken people, okay? And so what Jesus is trying to teach us to do is to become the kind of people who've done the hard work of our relationship with God the Father and receiving the forgiveness and the healing and the transformation from Jesus, so that when we go to someone, we invite them into the kingdom. Okay? So do you see the difference in smacking somebody over the head with the Bible, right? Because this is what you need. Okay? And we grew up in the culture of that, right? Versus what Jesus is saying is inviting people into the kingdom. Inviting people, and you the only way you can invite somebody into this super duper party that we're participating is if you're doing it, right? If you're experiencing the reality of the kingdom, if love and joy and peace and patience is flowing through you, then it's easy to say, come on, join this amazing journey that I'm on. I want you to be a part of it. I want you to experience this. And part of it is showing them Jesus, okay? A, he's the most intelligent person ever, and he's also the most loving and kind and compassionate, okay? And we're just offering that. That's what we're doing. We're inviting people to come into this kingdom. So keep asking, keep seeking, and keep knocking. Yes, at the same time we're doing that with Jesus, with God, okay? Ask, seek, and knock. We're also asking and seeking and knocking persistently with the person who we want to see either come into the kingdom or change. Okay? The way they, and always remember that the latch to the door of the heart is on the inside. Okay? So they have to unlatch the door to their heart, just like we had to unlatch the door to our hearts to let Christ come in. Okay? So we can make a difference in our persistent prayer. The two examples that are just beautiful, and we don't have a whole lot of time left, but Moses and Hezekiah. The people of Israel that came out, you know, he was up on the mountain. They were having this terrible orgy, and God was just, he said, I'm sorry I brought them out. I'm going to kill them all. What did Moses do? Okay, he went to God, and this is Moses, the humble guy, though he struck the rock. So he's very human, but he said, is this really what you want to do? And he interceded on behalf of the people and said, I would ask you not to do that. And God changed his mind. Okay, so yes, sovereign God, but persistent being in relationship to understand and being a person who is a follower, who is experiencing the kingdom, who's living in the kingdom. The other one's Hezekiah. You know, hey, you're going to die. He's like, oh. So he turns his face to the wall, is what the Bible says. And he prays, just cries out to God. And God heard and gave him 15 more years. Okay? So persistent, effective, asking our Father to work in another's life. And of course, before you do that, we got to do the self stuff, right? So that's what we're working on. We're working on becoming the kind of people who have dealt with all of our issues of anger and lust and possessions and all these things that we've listed before, right? So we've taken care of that, and we're no longer the people who condemn. Okay, that's our goal. And I'm not saying that you and I are there yet, but we're in process. We're working on it. Because at that point, we can say, okay, I want to give you, I want to offer, I want to invite you into this beautiful relationship that I have with God, where I have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, meekness, and self-control. Right? So we are on a pilgrimage, and it's a long journey. So I have two more points. But I am going to put those off. Well, okay, I'm going to give you a preview. The golden rule. Do to others what you would have them do to you. We homeschooled. And so we had these scripture songs, A through Z. I don't remember what Z was. But do, D was do to others what you would have them do to you, do to others what you would have them do. For this sums up the law and the prophets, and this is Matthew 7:12, right? So all my boys can just break out in song. They can sing the states and the capitals, but they can sing these scripture songs. And so the golden rule, the fact that Jesus is calling us to do to others in the same way that we would have them do to us. This sums up all of it. It's the law and the prophets. It's the entire word. Is that you and I are living the kind of lives to where we are naturally operating with everyone around us in the same way that we would want to be operated in. Right? Giving, loving, kind, compassion, patient. Right? Continually asking our Father, Lord, what would you have me say to them? How would you, if I'm trying to live my life the way Jesus would live it if he were I, then what would you do, Jesus? How would you respond to this person who's irritating me, or I see something that we need to work on? Okay? So consistently and constantly going to the Father in prayer, but offering and inviting people into healing. That's enough for today, and that's the journey we're on. And so we'll pick this up next week and see where the Lord takes us. Let's go to prayer, and then we'll be singing a song for the ending. So Father, we come to you, kneeling before your throne, humbling ourselves, asking that your kingdom would come, your will would be done, not only in our lives, in our domain, in our realm, in our homes, our work, our neighborhood, of course, in our state and in our country and in our world. Lord, may your kingdom come and your will be done in our lives and in the lives of the people around us. Lord, you are at work holding our hand as we are participating with you to become the kind of people who all of this beauty and love and joy and grace just naturally flow. So, Lord, thank you for your patience. Oh, thank you so much that you don't judge us every moment, every mistake, everything. And yes, we do confess. We are a sinful, broken people. And even though we try really hard to be good, apart from you, we can do nothing. So we are weak, but you are strong. So we trust in your strength. We trust in your work through our lives. And Lord, you got a lot of work to do. But we're holding your hand, and you're leading us. You're growing us. You're patient and kind. And so continue your work in our lives. Continue your work in C4 Church. God, you're doing amazing miracles, even though we can't see it sometimes. Show us how good you are, and show us Christ active and alive in our world, where we live, where we work, where we eat and breathe and sleep. Thank you for your grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Mark. Some great challenges this week we need to work on, yes? All right. Offering bags will be in the back as you go out. Give joyfully. All right. Let's see. Celebrate Recovery is on Tuesday. And then next Sunday, we're going to go ahead and we're going to celebrate our 25th anniversary. We're going to head to Papa Chino's. They have a really nice patio area, so we'll be after church about 11 o'clock. So please be there. We invite you to come. Why don't you stand up? We're going to sing one song as we go out. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your mind and with all your soul and with all your strength. Amen.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind.
when with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength.
Now we get to serve the Lord with all our heart, all of our mind, with all our soul and strength.
I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my mind, with all my mind, and with all my strength.
Amen. Go and have a great week and be the church scattered. Amen. All right.